Hey everyone, a very good morning to all of you. Myself, Neha Gupta, your mentor for current affairs, and this video is for your upcoming examinations like RBI, SEBI and NABARD. So guys, before moving ahead in this video, I would like to inform you all that I am going to take a session on August Spotlight, the remaining questions of August Spotlight at 10 a.m. today itself. So be on our channel and watch the session so that you can revise the questions of August Spotlight, because this is the preceding month, the immediate preceding month from your examination date. So those who are appearing for NABARD, this session is very important for you guys. Now, as far as today's session is concerned, so yes, majority of you have guessed it right. Yes, we are going to discuss about the textile sector of India as it is shown in this picture only. So recently, the government of India has approved the PLI scheme, the production linked incentive scheme in the textile sector. And this picture is an additional, is a value addition from my side. This picture is stating the different kinds of materials, textiles that are found in different parts of India. Okay, so this has nothing to do with the PLI scheme. Obviously, not directly to do with the PLI scheme. However, this is an additional point. So you can just have a look at the different kinds of textile fabrics that we find in different parts of India. Okay, now let's discuss the first question, which is about the PLI scheme in the textile sector only. But before moving ahead, guys, if you haven't subscribed our channel till now, then do subscribe and hit the bell notification. And also you can join the Telegram group. The link of the Telegram group is in description. The benefit of joining the group is that you will get the PDF of this session on that group. Okay. So the first question is, what is the minimum investment requirement for firms in the phase one of the PLI scheme for textiles? Okay, so as a matter of fact, I will tell you the answer here only, but the in order to understand what this mean and what is the scheme all about, we will have to look into the details of the scheme. So let's first know the answer. The answer is 300 crores, but you don't have to mug it up here, because we are going to understand the levels, the meanings and the details of the scheme right now. Okay. So guys, the production linked incentive schemes for the textile sector has been approved by the central government in order to boost the production of textiles. So if you remember, in the recent days, the central government has also formed a committee, that is the Sunil Sethi committee, in order to double the production of textiles in the next 3 years and quadruple the exports of textiles. Your task is to tell me the targets that this committee has been formed for. Okay, because I have taught you in the yesterday, basically in the last week's video only. As far as this scheme is concerned, so let's have a look at the facts first. So this has been launched for a period of 5 years. The outlay is ₹10,683 crores, and guys, this is a part of the PLI scheme, that is production linked incentive scheme of the government of India, which has an outlay of 1.97 crores. So this is the overarching scheme. The PLI scheme is the overarching or the umbrella scheme under which different sectors are there. For example, you have hardware sector, you have the automobile sector, you have this textile sector, food processing industries, similar kinds of sectors are there. So there are a lot of sectors under this PLI scheme. The total corpus of this PLI is 1.97 crores. But individual sector has its own outlay. For example, this scheme has an outlay of ₹10,683 crores. So do remember this thing. Now, expected investment through this scheme is 19,000 crores. Expected turnover of the textile industry, 3 lakh crore over next 5 years. Now we are talking about the turnover. Okay, and I have asked you about the production target for which the Sunil Sethi committee has been formed. So do not mix both of these things. एक्सपेक्टेड एम्प्लॉयमेंट जनरेशन इज ओवर 7.5 लाख, इंक्लूडिंग बोथ डायरेक्ट एंड इनडायरेक्ट एम्प्लॉयमेंट. Okay, so from this point, our conceptual understanding begins. So basically, the very first point is the focus area. What are the areas on which this scheme will focus? So the very first point here is that aspirational districts in tier 3 and tier 4 cities will be the priority of the government in this scheme. Okay, the next point is that it will promote high value man-made fiber fabrics, garments and technical textiles in the country, because the share of man-made fiber in the textile sector, in the textile production sector of India is less than 3%, whereas the global demand is over 75%. Basically, the man-made fibers and these technical textiles are consuming 75% of share in the global textile market, and India's share in these two segments is less than 5%. Therefore, these two are the segments on which the government is going to lay its focus. Now, man-made fibers are like polyester, nylon, the fibers like those which are synthetic fibers. Technical textiles are the textiles or the clothes that are prepared for their functioning only. That basically they are non-aesthetic clothes. For example, the space suit, that is also a type of textile, but that does not come under the normal textile, that comes under the technical textile. The bulletproof vest or the clothes that the firefighters wear, the PPE kits, okay, so all of this come under the technical textile sector. Now, how many targeted products are there? 64 items are being targeted, which are divided into 40 MMF, man-made fiber product lines, 14 types of MMF, man-made fiber fabric lines are there, and 10 segments or products of technical textiles are there. All these products have a high demand in the international market, but India's share is less than 5% in each of them in the global market. And in order to increase India's share, India's export in these segments, in which segment? Man-made fiber and the technical textiles. So in these two segments, this scheme has been launched. Sorry. Okay, so this is a production linked incentive scheme. That means once you attain a certain level of production or turnover, then you will start getting incentives on your profit or on your turnover. That is the basic meaning of this scheme. Now, the incentive will be rolled out in two phases. In the first phase, a firm needs to invest 300 crores, and once it becomes eligible, basically once it attains the level of rupees 600 crore, a turnover of rupees 600 crore, then the firm will become eligible for incentives under the scheme. I hope that you are getting my point. You have to invest 300 crores and give certain time to the production, and then your turnover will increase, and when the turnover reaches this level, 600 crores, then you will become eligible for the incentives. Okay, so the criteria is not limited to investment only, it is also catering to the turnover. The next phase will have rupees 100 crores. So in the next phase, an individual firm will have to invest only 100 crores, and when that firm becomes when that firm is able to garner rupees 200 crores of turnover, then it will become eligible for the scheme, for getting the incentives under the scheme. Now guys, what kind of investment? The criteria for investment has also been made clear by the government, that the investment should be made towards plant, machinery, equipment and civil works, excluding land and administrative building cost. Okay, so this is the investment criteria. So these were the facts, the conceptual side of this scheme. I hope that you have understood it well, but in case if you have any doubt related to the scheme, then you can ask me in the comment section or on the Telegram group. Moving on to the next question. So which state has announced to reintroduce the concept of industrial adalat in the state to resolve industrial disputes? So it is Karnataka. Basic purpose is to resolve the industrial disputes, to provide a common platform for the industry so that they can come forward and tell their problems that they are facing to the government agency, the responsible government agency. So that is the basic purpose. With which of the following universities has National E-Governance Division signed an MOU for setting up cyber lab for the online capacity building program on cyber law, crime investigation and digital forensics? The right answer here is option D, National Law University of Delhi, National Law Institute, University of Bhopal. Both of these have signed the MOU with National E-Governance Division, which comes under the Ministry of Electronics and IT, Information Technology. Okay. Now, this cyber lab will run this online capacity program, which will be for the police officers, special cyber cell officers, and it will act as a capacity building program for them in order to increase their capacity, increase their skills to tackle these cyber frauds, digital frauds. So that is the whole purpose of signing this MOU. Next question. Which of the following statement is incorrect about the sand and dust storms risk assessment in Asia and the Pacific report? So you have the five statements. It has been released by Asian and Pacific Center for the Development of Disaster Information Management. It analyzed the impact of sand and dust storms on the air quality. As per this report, more than 500 million people in India are exposed to medium and high levels of poor air quality due to sand and dust storms. The highest number of cities facing the dust storms, dust and sand storms, are in India. Sand and dust storms cause an economic loss of over $107 million for India per year. Now, what do you think is the incorrect statement here? The incorrect statement is this, option B. The highest number of cities facing the dust and sand storm is not India. Okay, so here India is on the positive side, but that does not mean that India does not have to face the consequences of dust and sand storms. There are a lot of dust and sand storms, as this point is highlighting, that more than 500 million people, that means 5 crore people in India, are exposed to medium and high levels of poor air quality due to sand and dust storms. Now let's have a look at this report in detail. So this report is released by this center, Asian and Pacific Center for the Development of Disaster Information Management, and this center is a regional institution of United Nations Economic and Social Commission for Asia and the Pacific. Do remember this thing. Now guys, as per this report, 500 million people in India and more than 80% of the population of Turkmenistan, Pakistan, Uzbekistan, Tajikistan and Iran are exposed to medium and high levels of poor air quality due to sand and dust storms. So basically, the one point that this report highlighted is that the Western Asian side, Western and Central Asia, is more prone to the sand and dust storms. Next, nearly 60 million people in Karachi, Lahore and Delhi have experienced more than 170 dusty days a year in 2019. Now, this point is not very important for your examination point of view, but it is just for your understanding that how severe is this sand and dust storm for the people living in these cities. The situation is much worse for 6 million residents of 8 cities across the region, 3 in China, 2 in Iran, two in Pakistan, and 1 in Uzbekistan. So China is having the highest number of cities where the people are prone or are facing the worst conditions due to the dust and sand storms. In 2019, sand and dust storms caused the loss of this much energy hours in India, which translated into an economic loss of $107 million for India. So in other words, we can say that due to the dust and sand storms, India faced an economic loss worth $107 million per year. Okay, so this would be the other way round interpretation of this point. That was all about this sand and dust storm risk assessment report. Moving on to the next question, how many principles are there in United Nations Global Compact? So here 10 principles are there, which are divided into 4 parts: labor, human rights, anti-corruption, and environment. Now basically, what is this United Nations Global Compact, which was adopted in 2000 by United Nations? So this is basically a non-binding pact, a non-binding agreement for the businesses so that their conduct can become socially and environmentally friendly. Okay, so in order to give a flip to the conduct of businesses so that they become friendly or conducive to the society and the environment, this United Nations Global Compact came into effect. So it has a total of 10 principles which are to be adhered by the companies joining this agreement. Okay, so those 10 principles are divided into these 4 domains. Okay, I hope that this is clear to you, clearly visible to you. Labor, human rights, anti-corruption, and environment. Next question. Who has been appointed as a brand ambassador of the Equitas Small Finance Bank? The right answer is option E, Rani Rampal, who is the hockey player, and Smriti Mandhana, the cricketer. So both of them have been chosen as a brand ambassador. So that was all for today. I hope that you have enjoyed the video. Do not forget to come at 10 a.m. to cover the August spotlight. Thank you so much for watching the session.